Good evening, everyone. Welcome. My name is Ellie Weisenberg-Kelly. I'm the Manager of Public Programs and Residencies here at the Pocantico Center. And it's my pleasure to welcome all of you to tonight's presentation and lecture with Dr. Gretchen Sullivan, Driving While Black. The Pocantico Center rests on Lenape Hoking, unceded land of the native Lenape people. We honor the Lenape, past, present, and future, in gratitude and appreciation for their stewardship of this land for generations. It's an honor to have Dr. Sorin here this evening on the first day of Black History Month, and we're so glad that you have chosen to join us for this special event. Tonight, Dr. Sorin will present a deeply compelling exploration of her award-winning book, Driving While Black, African-American Travel, and the Road to Civil Rights, and present film clips from her book's subsequent award-winning PBS documentary. Both the book and the film unravel layers of the experience of African Americans on the road and explores how the advent of the automobile brought new mobility and freedom to African Americans while also exposing them to discrimination and deadly violence along American highways, a history that still resonates today. Tonight's program explores realities that have been an indelible part of the African American experience for hundreds of years. And now it's my pleasure to tell you a little bit more about Dr. Gretchen Sullivan. Dr. Sorin is director and distinguished service professor at the Cooperstown Graduate Program, a training program for museum curators and directors within the State University of New York. Sorin is the author of Driving While Black, African American Travel and the Road to Civil Rights, a finalist for the NAACP's 2021 Image Award for Outstanding Literary Work. She was co-writer and senior historian with Steeplechase Films on the documentary film Driving While Black, Race, Space, and Mobility, which was a recipient of the 2021 American Bar Association Silver Gavel Award. Following Dr. Sorin's presentation, she will take some questions from the audience, and then we'll invite you all for some refreshments in the gathering space, and you can continue to enjoy our gallery exhibition, Portraits of Process. And now please help me welcome Dr. Sorin to the stage. Thank you.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. Thanks for being here on the first night of Black History Month. This book was a labor of love that I worked on for almost 20 years, a very long time. As a curator, I had gathered a lot of images. I was always gathering pictures throughout my research. And I went to a restaurant in Manhattan with Rick Burns, the filmmaker, and I said to him, I think this should be your next project. And we together looked at the images, and the staff at the restaurant gathered around to look at the images, and he said, yes, absolutely. And we then decided that that would be a film that we would make. So the clips that you're going to see, there are three clips from the film that I will show you. I'm only showing you a little bit, just as a little tantalizing spot. If you'd like to see the entire two-hour film, all you need to do is go to pbs.org and type in Driving While Black, and courtesy of General Motors, you can see it for free. So please do that. Ah, perfect. Thank you, George. I'd like you to think today about mobility and what mobility really means. The right to travel, the right to go where you want to go, when you want to go, is something that we all take for granted. So today I'd like you to consider how important your mobility is to you. The right to mobility is really something that's part of a free society, right? In a free democratic society, you can go, you can move around as you wish. A significant role in facilitating mobility for African Americans is the automobile, and I'm going to talk a little bit about that.
Every child,
running for Jesus,
like an automobile.
Every child,
running for
just
Jesus.
Child of God,
running for Jesus,
just like an automobile.
Prayer
is your driver's
license.
Faith is your steering.
That right into a film.
Mobility is essential to freedom. I think the automobile is emblematic of the importance and the value of mobility in a free society. But it also goes beyond mobility, and it allows us to understand the way that African Americans have moved forward in this country and the way that African Americans have been pushed back.
Could I see some ID, please, sir?
For what?
I need to see your driver's license registration.
For what?
Let me start out by saying, driving while black was always unsafe. Yet, by the same token, millions of African Americans did it.
I think the idea of driving while black is a really helpful way to understand that this form of mobility that Americans have revered and have enjoyed and have romanticized, you know, it's sort of part of kind of American iconography, and what it means to be American is to take to the road, to have this great expanse of the highway and to make memories with your family. And I think that the notion of driving while black reminds us that that's not available to all Americans.
For me, the term driving while black isn't just a slogan. It's not just part of our political rhetoric. It's not just something we say to remind ourselves of the persistence of racism in the United States. It's a very personal experience of remembering, in fact, the anxiety, the fear.
I think it's really, really tough for the majority of Americans to begin to even understand the gut-wrenching horror that is driving in a racist society.
Well, you know, driving while black is a very interesting concept, and it entails so much more than the actual driving while black. It's living while black. Sleeping while black, eating while black, moving while black. So when we start talking about the brutal restrictions on black movement in this country,
get the fuck out of the camp.
Well, that's a long history. That goes all the way back to day one.
So that's a clip from near the end of the film, and I wanted to show it because, as a historian, when I started out on this project, I thought that I was going to talk about the automobile and its relationship to African Americans from the 1920s until the 1960s, and then I was going to stop right there. And in working on the film and in working with my publisher, they kept saying, no, you've got to bring it up to the present. You've got to bring it up to the present. And I kept saying, but I'm a historian, and historians don't do the present. We do the past. But I think it ended up being very important to connect driving while black to the present, and that's what you just saw. So this is Times Square. You might not recognize it because it never looks like this. This was Times Square during COVID, completely empty. And I'm showing it to you because the whole idea of mobility and how important mobility is to all of us, and being able to move. And this is the second, wait a minute. That clip didn't start. Jordan.
Can you go back more?
Go back to Times Square? There it goes.
driving while black is a very interesting concept, and it entails so much more than the actual driving while black. It's living while black, sleeping while black, eating while black, moving while black. So when we start talking about the brutal restrictions on black movement in this country, well, that's a long history. That goes all the way back to day one. You have to get to the root of it. You know, where's the root of it?
I think for African Americans, any story about mobility really begins 400 years ago.
I think it's really important to look at the longer history of race, space, and mobility, because if we look to the past, we can really see how travel or mobility for African Americans has really been circumscribed. So if we think about, you know, the first Africans who came to the colonies through the Middle Passage and on slave ships, think about the trauma and the terror and the violence of that form of forced mobility.
If you just go back to those roots, back to the era of slavery, a chance to move around was very much regulated and controlled by those who were slave owners over people who were enslaved.
I think, you know, the extraction of black people's labor, the use of black people's bodies, their capacity to produce and to generate wealth required, in fact, restrictions upon their ability to move. And so much of American history, so much of American law is actually focused upon policing that movement, policing that mobility.
Many enslaved Africans never left a 1 mile area in their entire life because they were constrained to that plantation or that farm.
We were slaves. We belonged to people. Now I couldn't move from here across the street till I have a note or something from my master. And if I had that pass, I could go wherever he sent me.
The fact that you had to get a pass to go from one plantation to another, if you didn't have that pass, you were likely to be stopped by the slave patrols, and they were given permission to beat you and to mistreat you for having the audacity to think that you could travel on your own.
And talk about very, very early on, you know, the imposition, you know, the limitations that's imposed on black life. You're not allowed to go beyond this point. So right away, you have some elements of racial profiling from the very beginning of the black experience in America.
One of the things that I think is so interesting is how policing developed in the South. Policing starts with slave catchers. These are men who are part of the community who go around at night to make sure that enslaved people are not leaving their plantations. But they're also there to terrorize and to intimidate.
Slave patrols of the Old South are there to control black people's movements. To keep slaves from moving off plantations, to limit their ability to seek and find freedom by crossing boundaries and borders that they're not intended to cross. And it's not a regional problem. In the northern states, in places like New York City, there were regulations on black people moving about in the nighttime. And colonial New York and 18th century and 19th century New York went to, in fact, great lengths to police the movement of black people.
I am unable to travel in any part of this country without calling forth illustrations of the dark spirit of slavery at every step. Frederick Douglass, 1852.
So as I did the research that I thought was going to go from, 1920 to 1960, it kept expanding and it kept going in both directions until it went all the way back to slave ships, thinking about the ordeal of the Middle Passage and forced travel for African Americans, and then thinking about mobility and the fact that African Americans were required, in order to move from place to place, to have passes. You had to have some sort of paper or some tag like this that showed where you were allowed to be. And of course, freedom was so important to enslaved people that they ran away. They stole themselves from slavery and exercised their freedom of movement. And you saw the picture of the slave catchers who become basically the first police forces in the United States, the slave patrols that guarded the communities at night, primarily to protect protect the white population and make sure that there were no insurrections, but also to keep the enslaved population in check. And these badges that are the original badges from the plantation slave patrols are the models for modern police badges. In the early 20th century, African Americans exercise mobility by moving from the rural South to the urban North. And it is the story of the greatest mass movement of people in the history of the United States. So seeking opportunities in the North and fleeing racism and poverty in the South, as many as 7 million African Americans left their homes to go to places like Chicago, Detroit, New York, Philadelphia, and Newark, New Jersey, where my parents went. With expanding opportunities in education and employment came more and more black citizens among the ranks of the black middle class. And if you were middle class, moving into the middle class, disposable income makes leisure travel possible. So no longer are you just anxious to travel, to move, but you want to travel for fun, travel for leisure. When African Americans traveled on public conveyances, they were forced on trains into the Negro cars. And these were filthy, often filthy cars on the trains, some in the North as well as the South, because the train conductors didn't want to force people to get up and move when they crossed the Mason-Dixon line. So they would just segregate the trains all the way to the North. This is what a train car might look like for African Americans. This is what a train car might look like for white Americans. The same thing was true on buses. Buses were also segregated, of course. In the first half of the 20th century, behavior for African Americans was prescribed by geography, but also by custom. And quite a bit of the country was segregated. It wasn't just the South. In the South, custom was to have signs. So you had Jim Crow signs in the South. But in the North, there were no signs. So in the North, you didn't necessarily know where you weren't allowed to be. But buses, taxis, trains, phone booths, lots of restaurants, hotels, all of these places of public gathering were segregated. And this is a Jim Crow rail car. And you can see in the backs of the seats where it says colored, so the black people would sit behind that. The automobile, on the other hand, freed black travelers from the tyranny of the Jim Crow railroad car and the Jim Crow bus. It offered freedom of movement and dignity, but car travel itself was not worry-free. African Americans found that trains were segregated, and even conductors might ask black travelers to move to the Negro car, but when they were riding in their cars, they might encounter angry mobs. So it wasn't worry-free when you were traveling by car, but your car provided some level of freedom that you didn't have with public conveyances. So by the 1950s, the interstate highway system enabled upwardly mobile black families to be travel consumers, just as they were consumers of refrigerators and television sets and coffee percolators. And they used their travel dollars to buy automobiles. They bought automobiles and campers, and when they could, hotel rooms and restaurant meals just like other Americans.
African Americans wanted to travel just as white Americans wanted to travel. They wanted to see the country. They wanted their children to see museums and to see the national parks and know and love the country. The problem with going out in a car, you're traversing white spaces, and it could be quite dangerous. You had to take precautions, knowing the routes that you were going to travel, what communities you'd be going through, where you might stop for the night, because you could encounter a mob. You could make the wrong turn and end up in a community that was not very welcoming, that was not very friendly. And many, many African Americans during Jim Crow accidentally ventured into the wrong spaces.
There was this concept that you had to go from known people to known people to be safe. So it is a kind of word of mouth network that gets bigger and bigger because local knowledge, knowing people along the route, was enormously important. So these guides come in to fill in this gap because everybody doesn't know someone in all parts of the country.
So this is a travel guide. It's just a pamphlet that you could have gotten that lists all of these hotels and motels and guest houses. It has some advertisements on the back.
There were a series of travel guides that were produced that provided information for African American travelers about places to stay, places to eat, places that would be safe as they were driving along the road. There was Smith's Guide, there was Grayson's Guide, there was the Traveler's Guide. And of course, there was the Negro Motorist's Green Book, which is the guide that everyone has heard about.
We obtained the most important book needed for Negroes who traveled anywhere in the United States. It was called the Green Book. The Green Book was the Bible of every Negro highway traveler. You literally didn't dare leave home without it. Earl Hutchinson, Sr.
So that's where the Green Book was indispensable. It had to give you some way to find a place where you could be relieved, you can get some rest, get something to eat, you know, without being violated.
Guidebooks like this act as a kind of a transect through the American experience. So it's almost like cutting a section that cuts through tourism, the civil rights movement, education, professional advancement. Almost every kind of important thing that was changing in the 1950s and 60s is touched in some way by these guides.
Mark Twain said, "Travel is fatal to prejudice, bigotry, and narrow-mindedness." And this is the phrase that Victor Green adopted as his mantra for the Negro Motorist's Green Book. I think when Mark Twain said it, he was talking broadly about all people in all cultures. But I think for Victor Green, he was talking about travel being fatal to white prejudice.
Well, this is the whole thing. It's like separation permits the continuation and perpetuation of stereotypes and fear and disbelief. But every time people come together on equal terms, there is this moment where you don't have the apparatus of racism around you anymore. And there's a moment in an encounter where your racism is challenged. And so travel allows that to happen.
Victor Green's mantra was an effort to convince white people in this country that black people were just like you.
The Green Book actually does something for us that we need. It reminds us of the world that black people created under the regime of segregation. And we don't need to be nostalgic about Jim Crow to celebrate the extraordinary genius, the brilliance of black entrepreneurs, the men and women who built businesses in the confines of vicious segregation system.
There's a certain kind of harmonious collectivity there in terms of the overall progress of the people and how you can now unify and fight back against some of these elements of discrimination and segregation.
This is just new data to us. It's a new way to look at, to map Black businesses. I mean, the Green Book in and of itself was a travel guide, but it was also more of a testimony to Black entrepreneurship, really. I mean, to me, that's really what it is.
And so you have this parallel world that African Americans have constructed that enabled them to move forward, to continue moving forward.
So the make and model of cars that African Americans purchased was very important and very deliberate. According to a series of market studies of African Americans conducted in the 1940s and 1950s by market research firms, Black motorists preferred specific makes and models of cars for reasons that related specifically to race. I believe that African Americans preferred large cars because they offered protection, but you could also sleep in your car. So if you were traveling and you couldn't find a Black hotel or you couldn't find a hotel that would accept you, you could sleep in your car. You needed a space to carry lots of supplies, water for the radiator, extra fan belts, a cooler full of food, since restaurants and hotels would not serve you. I can remember as a child, my grandmother would always have a large coffee can that was a pea can, not the nut, in the car. And African Americans often carried that pea can in the car, and also blankets and pillows. So Black motorists created a home away from home in their cars, and they preferred large Buicks and Oldsmobiles. They were heavy, they were hard for a mob to turn over, and they had roomy trunks. And you can see, for African Americans, this was a very popular car, and this is the Electra Limited, and it says, all the Electra Limited lacks is a fireplace. It's a big, roomy car. And here you can see a family that's got all of their food in the trunk and they've just stopped by the side of the road. Now you may recognize Chuck Berry here. You've heard the stereotype of African Americans driving Cadillacs. African Americans drove Cadillacs in the same percentage that white Americans drove Cadillacs, about 3%. But because of attitudes toward African Americans, popular performers like Chuck Berry and Mahalia Jackson felt the need to justify their purchase of Cadillacs. But they drove them, A, because they could afford them, but also B, because they spent a lot of time in their cars. And often driving from gig to gig, they had to sleep in the car. And a Cadillac was a nice, large, roomy car that you could sleep in. When civil rights worker Medgar Evers needed a car to travel through rural Mississippi, he chose the Oldsmobile Rocket 88. The Rocket was large enough to enable Medgar to stretch out on the front seat because he was very tall, he was over 6 feet. But it responded immediately when he hit the gas pedal, enabling him to get away from a pursuing car. So that was another reason that African Americans chose powerful muscle cars like this and roomy cars. And there you can see that's the hole in the window. Medgar Evers died beside his car in his driveway, shot by a sniper in June of 1963. The automobile for African Americans was also a symbol of class status. And this is a Cadillac on the street in Harlem. Often prevented by discrimination from purchasing houses, their cars were the largest and most important purchase. So if you couldn't buy a house, you put your money into the second most expensive object that families buy, and that's a car. For African Americans, travel by car also posed a paradox. They had the freedom to travel, but they were forced, when they traveled, to stay in segregated Black neighborhoods and segregated Black tourist accommodations. So if you think about what life was like before the automobile, everybody stayed put. They didn't travel far from their neighborhoods. White people generally stayed in white neighborhoods. Black people generally stayed in Black neighborhoods. My husband often would ask me, we live in upstate New York, and every little town And you go 5 miles and there's a Baptist church, a Presbyterian church, an Episcopal church, perhaps some other Methodist church. And he would ask me, why is there a church in every 5 miles? Why don't they just have one? Well, it's because people stayed in their little communities. They didn't venture out into these broader areas. It was the automobile that caused people to move farther away, to go farther away. So the country was generally segregated by race, but with automobiles, African Americans start to crisscross the country. And when you're crossing the country, African Americans are now traveling from black spaces through white spaces. And that was dangerous. To get to a safe black space from another safe black space, you had to go through a variety of white spaces where you might not be welcome. So they faced billboards and posters and objects that ranged from insulting to frightening as they asserted their rights to unfettered travel, going where they wanted. The landscape for African Americans was fraught with psychologically and emotionally damaging messages like this one, which is a kind of welcome to Klan country. This is a popular hamburger chain on the West Coast called the Coon Chicken Inn, and diners entered the restaurant through the giant coon's mouth. It started in Salt Lake City, but filtered all the way through California. And this was the banner across the main street in Greenville, Texas. It says, "Greenville, welcome, the blackest land, the whitest people." And those words were also painted on the water tower. Also throughout the United States, there were sundown town signs. These were signs at the entrance of a town that were entire communities that wanted to keep African Americans out. They were places you might travel through during the day, but you needed to be out of these towns by sundown. And there were hundreds of sundown towns with signs like this all over the United States. Darien, Connecticut was a sundown town. Sheboygan, Wisconsin was a sundown town. They were everywhere, not just in the Midwest and not just in the South. And of course, you might face an angry mob as this African-American family did, trying to turn over their car. And imagine encountering this group at a local fair. This was a fair in Colorado. I can't get over this photograph. It's just amazing to me. So when the interstate highway system is built in the 1950s, it's often built through black communities. So as African Americans were embracing the automobile, black communities were being destroyed by interstate highways. This is the Route 80, the Dixie Overland Highway. But we have an idea in 1936, it runs until 1966, and that's the Negro Motorist's Green Book. Excuse me. And the Negro Motorist's Green Book is an idea that a businessman in Harlem has, Victor Green, and it's to create a guidebook that will help African Americans to find places that they can go, places of entertainment, places that you can get your car fixed, places that you can stay overnight, places that you can eat. The quotation from Mark Twain that you heard, "Travel is fatal to prejudice," appeared in Victor Green's guidebook. And here are Victor and Alma Green. Green was a postal worker. He had his business in Harlem. And one of the things that I always talk about is that Victor Green gets all the credit for the Green Book. However, he dies in 1960, and although his name continues to be on the Green Book publishing company was solely operated by Alma Green and four women. So it was a totally woman-owned and woman-operated publishing company from then on. And this is how Victor Green solicited readers for his Green Book. You could go to any Esso gas station. So I have a theory. Esso was owned by Standard Oil. Standard Oil was part of the Rockefeller was part of the Rockefeller brothers. I can't prove it, But one of the reasons that Victor Green was able to circulate the Green Book was that Esso circulated it for him free of charge. And they supported the Green Book. They advertised in the Green Book, they sold it, they handed it out, and they supported it. And there is not a bit of evidence or proof in the Rockefeller Library, but I'm sure that the fact that that Esso and Standard Oil were involved and that the Rockefellers were involved had something to do with the fact that it was supported and was successful. It was the most successful of the African-American travel guides. The Green Book included gas stations, hotels, motels, restaurants, YMCAs, churches, doctors, beauticians, and barbers. And each issue also contained at least one article. The Green Book obviously courted the black middle class, and it reflects black middle class values about politeness, about well-mannered behavior. Green believed that travel was fatal to prejudice, and he and his staff worked at ending discrimination, but in a very kind and well-mannered way. He never, in the articles, discusses openly discrimination or racism. He does it in a very rather secretive way. He says, as you see, carry your Green Book with you. You may need it. So he uses these euphemisms, but African Americans knew what he meant. There are also other very middle class guides, and you can see up there the black couple playing golf. The very early issues of all of these guides used YMCA dorm rooms and homes. So it'll say Mrs. John Smith, Mrs. George Freeman are offering rooms. So many of the rooms in the very beginning, not even hotels, but they're rooms in people's homes. And often a woman would make extra money by offering a room or two in her home and providing a breakfast. So these were kind of the early bed and breakfasts that were available to African Americans. This is an example. This is Rock Rest, which is in Kittery, Maine. And it was run by Hazel and Clayton Sinclair, and it is still standing. It's one of the few tourist homes and guest houses that's still standing. And that's Rock Rest. And one of my former students called me on a Wednesday and said, I found an African-American tourist home in Maine. And I was there on Friday, that Friday after work, and it was still intact. And you can see here the shelves of all of the pretty little china that she had. And she had, these are the ladies who lunch. She provided luncheons for the local African-American women. And she also catered for the white community, for the larger white community. And in those days, in the 50s, this is from 1952, people would write letters and ask, do you have room? Often it was parents who were taking their kids to college. You might be headed to Bowdoin, bringing your kids, you need a place to stay, and you would write to Hazel and ask her if she had had room for you. Rock Rest was completely intact. It had never, the door had been closed when the Sinclairs died, and their son never touched it again. So it was completely, completely intact, including her lobster plates and her glasses. You see her glasses right there? It was quite an amazing place. And of course, working with the Smithsonian, all of these objects are now a part of the Smithsonian. So segregation created a demand for a national network of African-American tourist houses, guest homes, and motor courts. Most of them were black owned. Some were owned by whites, but catered only to black people. And here you can see what an ad in the Green Book looked like. And people often put their picture. They wanted you to know, you know, this is a black owner, and this is what we have to offer for you. This grainy image demonstrates that perhaps the national parks were not America's best idea, and that the national parks, even though they were not supposed to be segregated, were segregated. And this is Shenandoah National Park. And you can see it says picnic area for Negroes. So one of the things that I think is really important about the automobile and about driving while black is that the civil rights movement, I argue, could not have happened without the car. This is an ad for Ware's supermarket in Memphis. Ware uses the Green Book to tie himself to Martin Luther King. So that's, it was a dangerous thing to do, but it's something that he did. But that's not the only reason that's not the reason automobiles were important. For bus boycotts, for all kinds of demonstrations, African Americans needed places to stay. When they went south to participate in marches, in boycotts, they needed places to stay. And the places that they stayed were the black hotels, the black motels that were used by tourists. Many of the places, and many of these destinations, like this is A.G. Gaston's motel. You think of the Lorraine Motel, which is where Martin Luther King stayed and was shot and murdered. This is A.G. Gaston's motel, which was bombed. These people who operated these businesses were taking great chances. This was a very, very dangerous thing to do. But those were places that were very important. This is a Volkswagen minibus that is at the Smithsonian. And on the side it says, love is progress, hate is expensive. This bus was used to travel throughout a county. If you think about how you would register voters in a county, if you were responsible for registering an entire county of voters, how would you do it? You had to have a vehicle in the South. And this vehicle was used to travel around the South and do training, doing education, they did vaccinations, and they registered voters. So that was one reason that an automobile was very important. Another reason that an automobile was very important, and here you can see Martin Luther King ushering some women into an automobile. During the bus boycotts, people wanted to continue to go to work. They didn't want to take the buses because they wanted to boycott the buses because the buses were segregated. Martin Luther King and the organizers of the Montgomery bus boycotts bought a fleet of automobiles, and they used that fleet of cars to drive people to work. Without that fleet of cars, they could not have bankrupted, as they did, the bus company, the Montgomery bus company. So how does the story end? In 1964, LBJ passes major civil rights legislation that extends voting rights and outlaws segregation. The NAACP and other civil rights organizations protested major hotel chains, and there were test cases. Test cases for Howard Johnson's and test cases for Hilton. And they lose. And all of public accommodations legally must be open to African Americans as well as to other Americans. But the question is, does the story end? This is Philando Castile, who I'm sure you remember was murdered in his automobile by a Minnesota police officer in 2016 in Falcon Heights, Minnesota. And the officer was acquitted of manslaughter. More recently, this is Kadir Nelson's cover for The New Yorker. That is a reminder that African Americans going out on the road is still very dangerous in 2023. So Stuart Carlson, who's a former editorial cartoonist for the Milwaukee Journal Sentinel, created this cartoon for drivers stopped by the police, be courteous, obey all lawful orders, have license and registration ready, and avoid being black. So the Green Book was out of business, and the black hotels and motels gradually lost their clientele to the large hotel chains, because when Hilton and the large hotel chains opened to African Americans, they went because they could, because they had been prevented from doing so in the past. So it's forever changed the landscape, of this country, but we're still dealing with African Americans driving while black. So I invite your questions, your comments, your stories.
Yeah. We'll bring the microphone around if anyone has anything they'd like to ask or say.
First of all, that was wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you.
You showed a picture of one of the hotels, I can't remember the name of it, that was bombed. But I'm wondering, given that these green books were in Esso stations and people were advertising, you know, hotels, mm-hmm. and their picture was on it, weren't there more targets, unfortunately, violence against those people or those hotels? I mean,
The primary targets were the places that Martin Luther King, Ralph Abernathy, that the primary civil rights workers were staying, if it was known. You know, it's interesting. There was a place in Dookie Chase's in New Orleans that we actually interviewed Dookie Chase's wife. She died, I think, last year, but she was 96, and she talked about this, and she said nobody ever bothered, that the civil rights workers used to meet there, and that she had photographs of people meeting there, and nobody ever bothered them in New Orleans. But in the South, in Alabama, in Georgia, yes, there were bombings, there were lots of problems. But primarily where the civil rights leaders stayed.
Hi, that's two quick questions. Was there segregation on airlines in the
yes.
early days? What was
so,
that like?
That's a very interesting question. So because airlines are controlled federally, there is not supposed to be any segregation on airlines. However, airports are not federally owned. So there was lots of segregation in the airports. So for example, there were airports in Texas that didn't have bathrooms for African Americans. They only had white bathrooms. And there was a lawsuit in New York against American Airlines because the flight attendants, then called stewardesses, used to mark the tickets. So they would mark a ticket if it was African American, so they'd put all the black people together so that people wouldn't say, I don't want to sit next to that person. And they were sued and they lost. So because they're federal, There was no federal segregation legislation, so they weren't supposed to be segregated. But there's a great story that Robinson. Rachel Robinson. I'm from Cooperstown. I should know baseball, but I don't. Rachel Robinson told me this story about Jackie Robinson. So. Jackie Robinson and Rachel are going to Florida for spring training. And they get on a plane in California, and she's got on her ermine coat, and she's all dressed up. And Mrs. Robinson, her mother-in-law, shows up with a shoebox full of fried chicken. And she is mortified. Oh my God, I'm carrying, but she doesn't want to insult her mother-in-law, right? So she takes the fried chicken, and they get on the plane, and they fly the first leg, and it goes to Texas, and they get off the plane. In Texas, Texas won't let them back on the plane because they're black. And so now they're stuck, right? They're stuck in Texas, and they don't know what to do, so they call Branch Rickey, and he tells them, get a hotel room. So the only hotel room they can get is in the black part of town. It's not a great hotel, no restaurant, but they have a box of fried chicken. So it turned out that Mrs. Robinson was right, and they had a box of fried chicken. And there are lots and lots of stories about these shoeboxes that African Americans carried. And there's, you know, they would have fried chicken, a can of juice with a can opener, right, because you didn't have those pull tabs, a piece of fruit, a cookie, or a piece of a brownie or something. And they would carry these shoeboxes of food so that you had something to eat.
Is there one other just quick question? Gas, getting gas for while traveling? Or is it, was it?
My father would only buy Esso. And I think it was not only, you know, I think the Rockefellers had enlightened self-interest because it was just so smart. The African-American market, the marketers were saying, this is a market. Look at this. This is, you have a growing middle class. You can make money. And so many African-Americans would only buy Esso gas, go to Esso, because they knew that they did not discriminate. They would, Esso allowed black people to use their bathrooms, and they sold them, were willing to sell gas. One of our informants, one of the people that I talked to, I did a lot of oral histories for this, said that he went to a gas station and the guy told him he would take his money, but he couldn't use the bathroom. And he said, he hung the gas thing up, went across the street to the Esso station, and never looked back, only went to Esso gas stations.
This is also fascinating. Thank you so much for giving this talk. I'm curious about whether it was hard to purchase a car. Was there discrimination at that level of car sales?
So it was hard. It was hard for African Americans to purchase a car, but they worked hard. So lots of ways to do it. There were a few black automobile dealers, especially in Detroit. So you could buy from a black dealer. You could buy a used car from somebody. You could get a white friend. You know, not everybody was a bigot. You could get a white friend to buy a car for you. And that's basically what happened. It was hardest for African Americans to buy luxury cars because car dealers just didn't want to sell Cadillacs or fancy cars to black people. You shouldn't own that kind of a car. But there were dealers that were willing to take the money if you had the money. It's interesting that automobiles, you know, you would, American Jews do not buy Fords because Ford was a raging anti-Semite. But African Americans bought Fords because Ford hired African Americans to work in the factory. So African Americans like Ford, even though he's an anti-Semite. American Jews won't buy Fords. So it's kind of interesting to see how people's politics determines what automobile they would drive. Actually, I think it probably still does.
I imagine that people had to take out loans back then to buy cars. Did they have difficulty getting loans?
So there were black insurance companies and black banks. I think one of the things that people don't realize is that the African-American community was almost like a completely separate community. But it was difficult, but a car was a lot less expensive. And you might be able to buy a used car pretty inexpensively, maybe for $200 or $300. And a Model T was, I think, $1,700. They weren't compared to what people made in those days. But they still were much more manageable than now. What is a car? $40,000? And also, if you couldn't get a mortgage, right, you put your money into your car if you couldn't get a mortgage at the bank.
I wanted to ask where you found all those wonderful and poignant images in the film. It was remarkable to see these snapshots of black personal lives and to see individuals enjoying their vehicles and enjoying their families in a way that we don't often get to see in media. And I'd love to know more about how you found those images and how you sourced them.
We looked for home movies, and we looked at home movie collections across the United States, and also the African American Museum in Washington, D.C. has a home movie collection now. The little girl with the red ribbons in her hair is me. And my father took that image, and while we were in the middle of working on the film, I found some old film, and I gave it to Rick Burns and said, you know, my father used to take home, we're looking at home movies. Here's some home movies. Let's see what's on it. And we found that piece of, that clip of film. So that was a great find for, it was like, perfect. It's in a car. we mined collections all over the United States. We traveled from the East Coast to the West Coast. I did a lot of oral history interviews. So we, and every time I talked to somebody, I asked them if they had film, if they had home movies, if they had albums. And so that's where a lot of the images came from.
Amazing, I can't wait to see the film. But were there any total surprises along the way, like shockers that you recall? Just
shockers. There were a lot of, I think there were a lot of shockers. Wow, that's a kind of a great question. What were the real shockers? I think, you know what the real shocker for me was? How many white men wrote to me about their experiences with cars? It was, you know, I think one of the shockers was the car has such resonance for Americans that people really identified with the film. You didn't have to be black to identify with this film. People identified with going on vacation. They identified with getting a car. You know, going. You didn't have to be black. And that I found really surprising. I didn't realize that people would identify so much with the automobile. And I realized how people expect that I know a lot about cars. And I really don't. If you were to say, what was that car on slide? It's like, I don't know. So I know about a lot about the history of cars, not a lot about, I can't tell you, I can't identify a car by looking at it very well. I mean, I know a Volkswagen bus when I see one, but. But I think that was the shocker, that Americans really identify with automobiles.
Hello. Hi. I'm over here. I'm curious to know what prompted you to research this specific area in terms of African-American and travel. Was it something personal? Was it something on the national scale? I'm just interested how you found, how you decided to research this area. And thank you so much. I really enjoyed your presentation.
I was working with a colleague who was a scholar at Bard College. And she and I were working on an exhibition in Saratoga Springs, New York, on the history of African Americans in Saratoga Springs. And she had found the cover of a green book. And this is a long time ago. And she asked me if I ever had heard of it. And at that point, my mother was still alive. And I took it home and I asked my mother if she ever heard of the green book. And she said, nope, never heard of it. And I was fascinated. And I thought, what is this? You know, here's this green book that I have, and this is long before the Green Book movie, you know, and I just was curious about it, so I thought I'd do some research. And one of my graduate students was from Chicago, and I discovered that the Chicago Public Library had a collection of green books. And when he went home for Christmas, I asked him if he would copy one of them so I could see it. And I looked at it, and it was fascinating, and I couldn't think why historians had never written about it. You know, why was it, it's been around for, you know, since the 1930s and no historian had written about it. And I think it's because it's basically a phone book. Mm-hmm. You know, there's, when a historian looks at a document like that, what are you gonna write, right? Mm-hmm. It's somebody's name, it's a state, so it starts with Alaska, it's alphabetical, and it's a name of a state, it's a name of a person, and then their address. And that's the green book. So it's basically a phone book. So what are you gonna do with that? Mm-hmm. But I'm a curator and I think of things, you know, I was thinking of this as material culture. And I thought, I think I can do something with this. Mm-hmm. You know, in fact, I think there are a lot of things you can do with it. And since then, people have done a lot of things with it. You could map it, you can try and find these places. You can, you know, people have done a lot of things. Mm-hmm. But until that point, nobody had done anything with it. So, but that's how I got started.
Yeah.
And it just grew from the green book to the automobile, to travel.
I'm right next to her. Oh. I moved here from St. Paul, Minnesota, and that was a place where, as in many cities, the African American community was wiped out mm-hmm. by the highway, but one of the interesting things to me is that many African Americans made their living working on the trolley cars mm-hmm. and as conductors on trains. And in about 2010, when I was living there, they were building a new light rail line from downtown Minneapolis to downtown St. Paul. And it was going right by the African American community and two other neighborhoods, one that was primarily Southeast Asian and another that was primarily Somali. And in order to get money to build the line, they, from the federal government, which they needed the funding, they needed to remove some of the stops along the line. And of course they chose the stops yeah. where people needed the transportation the most. And removed those. And we worked with a multi community group for 5 years to get those stops put back in. And we succeeded by having the federal government actually change the requirements for getting federal money, giving extra points, so to speak, to economically
oh, good for you.
Challenge. But I'm curious about whether the trolley lines and the railroad jobs were part of what enabled African Americans to rise up into the middle class.
Well, certainly the Brotherhood of Sleeping Car Porters, the porters on railroads, that was a great position for African Americans because they made good money and they traveled all over the United States. And so most of them were not conductors, they were porters. And many of those porters, some of those porters were physicians, some of them were lawyers. They were people who couldn't get jobs other than working as porters, and they made good money. And that also facilitated movement into the middle class.
Yeah, I'm just curious about your thoughts about the book bans as a historian.
About book bans?
Yes.
I think they're ridiculous.
What can communities do that have these bans, associated with their communities?
What can they do?
Yeah.
I have. I mean, I think that you can vote. I don't think book bans are a good idea. I think that parents may want to prevent their children from reading certain books at certain times in their lives, but we should never burn books. I mean, what frightens me about this climate that we're in right now is that it looks very much like the 1930s, when the in 1930s in Europe, when books were being banned and other things were being. Other civil liberties were being eliminated, and so it's pretty frightening, and it doesn't represent democratic behavior for a democratic society. So it's I think pretty scary, pretty frightening. It makes me very glad I live in New York State.
And that's why we have to go out and
vote. Exactly. I think voting is incredibly important.
Hi. Thanks.
Thank you.
I'm curious about what you were working on or what your research led you to before this project, and if you have anything you're working on now.
Before this project, so I have done everything from 18th century history. I was the director of an 18th century tavern in Virginia. Before this project, I was working on an exhibition at the Smithsonian called, about Martin Luther King that was done. It was about the art that was done after Martin Luther King's death in celebration of his life. And now I'm trying to reconstruct, with difficulty, Fayetteville, North Carolina in the 1940s, which is the community that my parents met in, that I talk about in the book briefly. They met in 1941 in Fayetteville, North Carolina, because my father, who was a New Yorker, was shipped down there, drafted, went to Fort Bragg, met my mother, who lived in Fayetteville, and went to an HBCU, Fayetteville State. And my mother, whenever you asked her, I was talking to my son about this the other day, because whenever you asked her about what it was like to grow up under segregation, she would say, well, we only knew the good white people. And she would never, ever, doesn't that sound like her? She would never say anything bad about anybody. And I recently read a book that was really fascinating, where an African-American scholar goes to his elderly aunt, who actually knew people who had been slaves. And he takes a pad and he wants her to transfer all that knowledge about those people that she knew who had been born slaves. He wants all that information to, you know, transfer it to his generation. And she says to him, I am not gonna tell you anything. I want you to look forward, not back. We don't wanna think about slavery. We don't wanna think about that. And she said, I'm taking it to the grave. I will not tell you. And I thought, wow, his aunt is my mother. You know, she didn't want to talk about those bad times, those bad things, and not document that history. And that's very common in a certain generation of African Americans. You know, they don't want to look back at all. They want to look forward. And they don't want to say anything bad. And they don't want to remember that time period. And it's not everybody, but there is a certain group. So I actually have started to try and see if I could reconstruct that place and that time through documents and newspapers and things like that.
Hi, thank you for this extraordinary work. I am curious, you were talking about the fact that there was a black community and self-contained, they had black banks. But then you also mentioned people didn't have mortgages, so they bought cars. What about the owner of, say, the motel that's on that screen?
Gaston made a fortune. He owned multiple businesses, and he was actually quite conservative. He would have been kind of a Booker T. Washington guy. He was a very conservative businessman, and he's only radicalized when he sees fire hoses being used to roll black children down the road, down the street. So it's during the civil rights movement that he gets radicalized and starts to put his money into civil rights. He was a very conservative businessman before that.
But he got a loan, obviously.
You mean a loan to build his...
To own property, yeah.
You know, there is actually a book on Gaston that I haven't read thoroughly, so I don't know. But he had motels, he had an insurance business, he had a funeral business, he had multiple businesses in the black community. And there were other businessmen like him, and he actually had one room, I think it was room number 33, that Martin Luther King stayed in all the time, and that's what they tried to bomb, but King wasn't there that night that they bombed it. Mm. But he was radicalized by that experience of watching those little children be
hosed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Thank you.
Hi. When Green did the first book, how did he get this list of, you know, all 50 states, Alaska, all these businesses, places to go, especially, you know, before the internet?
The first book is the first book is really skinny, and it is basically New York, a little bit of New Jersey, a little bit of Connecticut, a little bit of Pennsylvania, and mostly New York. In fact, mostly New York City. So he then starts to expand, and in subsequent volumes, he goes he goes out and down. So he gets the entire East Coast, and then he does east of the Mississippi, and then he gradually expands it every time. And the way he does it is by word of mouth. So he invites people that have stayed at a place to write in and say, I stayed at the Bluebird Motel, and it was great. And then he puts it in. And he also sends out letters, and he says, you know, if you'd like to be included, you know, just write to me and let me know that you want to be included. And he starts to ask friends and personalities. So, you know, if he knows of some actors or, so the, who are the people that are traveling the most, right? Baseball players are doing a lot of, so sports people are doing a lot of traveling. Musicians, you know, people that are entertainers are doing a lot of traveling. So he's getting as many of those people as he can to give him recommendations about places to stay. And it is gradual, you know, it just, if you look at the very, all of the Green books, by the way, if you want to see every Green book that exists, you can go to the NYPL, the New York Public Library, and they're all online. And you can look, you can just click on them and click on 1938 and see the, you know, see what they look like. And they're fascinating. But the very first one is basically New York City and a little bit of Connecticut and New Jersey.
Can take one or two more. Oh, go ahead.
Hello, thank you so much for this. I don't know if anyone's ever told you how triggering this is.
Triggering?
Yeah. I mean, informative. I have a son who's 28. He's a law student at Georgetown last year. Right. And he has wanderlust like both his parents. And loves to travel in the U.S. I always traveled overseas, and I always pushed him, no, go to Senegal, go to wherever. Mm-hmm. But he loves the national parks. And so I'm always terrified. And he's 28, 6 feet tall, muscular guy.
I
make him, like, put on that tracker, you know? So it is triggering, but I
appreciate it. I have a black son as well. As a historian, it's important for me to make sure that people understand the real story. Like, I don't want to sugarcoat it. I try not, like, I'm not showing a lot of really horrific images.
Sure.
I that's something that I've thought a lot about. I've done exhibitions that include lynching and, you know, talked a lot about, you know, how do you display a lynching image? How large do you display a lynching image? What constitutes exploitation of the people in the image or exploitation of the audience? I've thought a lot about that. So I do try to select images with care.
Sure.
But I also don't sugarcoat history.
No, I really appreciate, I'm like incredibly grateful for this. I just generally limit what I expose myself to.
Mm-hmm.
And I was incredibly, you know, interested in this, and a good friend of mine said, you have to come see it. He knows I'm a bit of a historian. Craig Wilder is somebody I dated like 40 years ago, so that was a big surprise. But, you know,
I'll tell him. I said, Craig, you met one of your old girlfriends.
But honestly, I mean, I literally had a visceral reaction, but I probably have that to a lot of things. But, you know, relating it more closely to my field, which is public health, and I'm also always thinking about, you know, upstream drivers of health inequities, and just the idea, just what you mentioned about being investing in a car versus a house, the depreciating asset and the, you know, wildly appreciating asset, you know, so that was just a really new concept that I hadn't heard before, so I was really grateful to hear that.
There's an entire section of the book that's not in the film about public health, because automobile accidents were incredibly dangerous for African Americans. Because if you got into an automobile accident, there were only 200 Negro hospitals in the United States.
Right.
And so if you didn't happen to be near Tuskegee or Howard or, you know, there was one in Newark. If you didn't happen to be near a Negro hospital and you were in a car accident, you could die. And there were actually HBCUs that would not allow their sports teams to travel because they were afraid they'd get into car accidents. Because there was an example of some students from Clark University who had gotten into a car accident and one of them died because they weren't near a hospital. But if you think about Bessie Smith, the singer, she dies because a white hospital won't take her. So there are lots of stories related to automobile accidents that, you know, a film can't do everything. And so that whole section was left out of the film, but it's in the book. So public health is really an issue, and the inequity in hospitals is really an issue that continues as well. That could be another whole film.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I think that's our last question.
Hi, I'm just curious, as far as other marginalized communities, did you find the equivalent of a green book, meaning like in the Jewish communities or in any other communities, that they would sort of, you know, pre-internet accumulate this kind of information for their own?
I could have written that question. That's a great question. So in the very first green book, Green says that he got the idea for the green book from our Jewish brethren. So for American Jews, there were these books that were called the Daily Kashrut. And in the book, there were recipes, there was a listing of holy days, and there were places to stay. And the places to stay were places that would provide you with kosher food, but also that would not discriminate. Because many of the hotels and restaurants, if you called and said, "Hi, my name is Schwartz," or "My name is Levine," they would say, "We don't have any rooms. You can't stay here." And so the Jewish community starts with some sort of guides, and the Green sees those guides. Green, the story is that Green has a bad experience. He goes out on a vacation. He has a very bad experience. He wants to do something about it. He says, "My Jewish brethren gave me the idea for this guidebook." There have also been, subsequently, gay guides that provide places for people who, for the LGBTQ community, that are safe spaces. So it's about finding safe spaces. And yes, there are other communities that have been putting together guides. And there are still some guides.
I think that's all we have time for tonight, but I just want to say another thank you and debt of gratitude to Dr. Sorin for an incredible presentation. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you all for coming. Have a good night.